Can you move it back a little bit?
Light, focusing through a lens and carving an image onto an emulsion-coated sheet of film, has mesmerized this photographer and created images which mesmerize audiences for decades.
It's a magic thing. I found that I photographed hundreds of women. We interviewed thousands of women.
Peter Gowland has launched the careers of hundreds of blooming actresses and models. Has a unique way of helping his models to relax and smile.
Is everybody in the mood?
And I'm here today shooting with Peter Gowland, one of my favorite photographers. He's great to shoot with and he makes the girls feel at ease.
He has lectured around the world to huge audiences about the craft of lighting, posing, and exposing women. At 78, he is still building his own sets and managing the production of his own line of specialty cameras.
We make mostly 4x5 cameras, but we make 2.25 cameras for roll film, and we make 5x7 cameras like this one.
Peter Gowland is not alone. His wife, Alice, he says, is the real brains behind his career.
Alice is the one that notices the details. I become the quiet one. And the client's here and everybody's ready to go and everybody says, where's Alice, where's Alice? And Alice walks in and she said, well look, you photographed this girl and you have hair hanging all over her chest. I didn't even notice it.
This is the story of the personal side of a man and woman who have spent 52 years together, surrounded by enviable, dazzling faces.
Like a bachelor.
It's like working in a candy store. You sort of sometimes you want to taste the candy, but it's not good for you.
There's a lot of love and attention in this thing. You know, it's a living thing, and Peter and Alice have worked on it for so many years that it's become, I always say, part of their life.
Try to find perfection, and there's no such thing as perfection. So what we try to do is to find the model with the least amount of problems. And one girl had fake breasts, and she had false teeth, and we were able to get around all that stuff. I think I like it better photographing a girl with imperfection and hiding the imperfections than I do trying to find someone that's too perfect. But there's no one that's perfect.
Thank you.
I've been doing makeup for Peter and Alice, I think, for 11 years. Yeah, it's definitely an art form. You know, what Peter and Alice do is an art form. Everything's very specialized. We all have our own little, you know, spaces that we're in charge of. And
I've been working here with Peter for the last around about 4 years now. And
Seems like yesterday.
I assist Peter, and it's been a wonderful job.
During an average day outdoors, when the Gowland crew is shooting a model, passers-by are quite obviously impressed.
The men that honk their horns are wonderful. If they didn't honk their horns, I'd worry about it, because if I photograph a girl at the beach and nobody looks at her, I know I've got a loser. But the more people that honk their horns, the better it is.
Peter and Alice Gowland admire the work of other photographers.
Richard Avedon, I think.
But I was talking about Richard Avedon today to this photographer in New York, and Richard Avedon, mm-hmm. It's a real contrast in technique. He's got these fantastic ideas, and then he shoots the other people, mm-hmm. and they're famous people, but shot in a very unflattering way.
One of them is like reality, and the other is fantasy.
You know, photographers tend to look at other photographers like Annie Leibovitz, and I think the secret of Annie Leibovitz is I find a common denominator running through her pictures. Mm-hmm. She has the same light, which is this great big broad light. What you gotta do is get your technique down to simplicity so your pictures are consistent. And I think we tried to do that. We've worked out a technique of, I think, like Annie Leibovitz, that we can guarantee that we're gonna get this girl to look the best way she can by giving her backlighting and, mm-hmm. and front fill with strobe. I met Ansel Adams and
I was absolutely amazed because I had only known him for his scenics. And he has some of the most wonderful pictures of people and things that I don't even associate with Ansel Adams. He really was, to me, an artist. He had that eye, you know, for things and the patience to wait.
He was completely dedicated.
Completely dedicated, that's the thing. That to me is what an artist is, someone who really is dedicated to what they do.
I like to do nudes because they're difficult.
When I was first married and Peter said he wanted to do nudes, my eyes just pop out practically because I thought, oh, nudity. But that's what I really love about Peter, because he's always been this very natural, open person, where I was raised a little more sheltered and had these thoughts. So rather than reject that, I love it that he opened up my eyes to these things. And I found that I really enjoyed doing the nude sessions with the girls, because it's really very difficult to, you know, with no clothes on, to make, you'd study, it's mostly form, shadows, lighting.
This picture on the wall evolved from, like I say, we just put two lights on the background, we poured water all over the floor, and the water ran all over the house, but I didn't even care. I don't like the body to be light, I like it to be shadow.
I think it's beautiful that the Gowlands can work together. You know, a lot of married couples, they're better off not working together because too much contact makes for too much friction.
Now, take those away. Alice.
I want to look and see what they turned out.
But I haven't looked at them yet. Alice.
Oh, wow.
Alice, come back here.
That's adorable.
Alice, if you were getting paid, I'd be firing you, Alice.
Neither of the Gowlands went to college. They grew up in an era when it was considered a substantial success to just finish high school.
It's out.
This is a curtain rod here, and these are aluminum cans from Tuna. When you go up the store, you buy these little cans, and you can buy these at the hardware store. Busy Bee has these.
And these are a couple of, this thing came from another thing. I pick up junk in the street on Tuesday mornings when the garbage goes out, I go out and look around and pick up all this stuff. This was part of a chair that someone threw away, see? So we just put this pipe on here, see? So it makes a nice little stand. No cost.
If necessity is the mother of invention, struggle in childhood may be what inspires the self-employed.
My mother was an actress and a poet and a Buddhist. And she had a sad life. She was divorced from my father when I was 2 years old. And then she was married again to a fellow who was an alcoholic. My education was traveling with my dad around the world. I mean, I was in England and Florida when he was working on all these movies. He was a good actor. I didn't really graduate from high school. My father died in England, and he wasn't making any money. And he was over there for about 5 or 6 years, living in a small room in Golders Green, north of London. And he never wrote to me. So they called me, the bank in Hollywood called me and said, your father's dead in London, what are we gonna do about it? And I said, well, I guess you should go ahead and bury him. My mother died here when I was in Germany. When I went overseas, with my wife and my two daughters for 3 months. She came to the airport to say goodbye, and she was so upset about us leaving that she just ran away, and I didn't see her again. That's the last time I ever saw her, because 2 weeks later, she died in, I think, the Santa Monica Hospital.
Maybe we get the thing cut, we can.
Obviously, without much support from his mother and father, and without much education,
you put it on there,
Peter has somehow relied on his hands
works.
And his wits to accomplish and acquire all that he has.
You pull it out again, a new sheet in the front.
Like many artists wrapped up in their crafts, Peter is not adept at the administrative aspects, the bookkeeping, publicizing, and distributing of his products. Those duties fall into the hands of his wife, Alice.
Peter Gowland Studio. I have to answer all the questions on the phone. It isn't any fun for me at all.
She does all the dirty work. She does all the paying people and buying supplies. And it's not creative to her.
But the photography was creative. You know, you hire the models and think of what picture, what costume, where you're going to take it. And that was always kind of fun. It still is fun. But so the camera business is not really that much fun.
But I can't get out of it now. It's too late. I'm stuck.
Just as Alice keeps the camera business afloat, she also happens to be the best salesperson of Peter's pictures.
Okay, it's to acknowledge when Peter was overseas, the last day we were together, he photographed a girl at the beach. I thought, gee, he should just be with me on the last day. But when he was gone, I looked at the transparencies, and I just looked at the magazines on the newsstand. I selected one called C. So I sent, I think, 3 of the transparencies in, and they bought 2 of them. I couldn't believe it when they sent me a check. I think it was $200 for each picture. And we've never seen that kind of money before. When we first started and built our GI business, we had no conception of all of how we were going to make money. So we lived in near Cheviot Hills. We would go up to one of the homes, knock on the door, and I would say, oh, hi, I'm Alice Gowland, and I write for the Los Angeles Times home section. Would you like to have your home in the magazine? Now, I didn't write for the Los Angeles Times. They would say yes, and then Peter would take the pictures. I would help him. We'd move furniture, get really pretty pictures of interiors. And then I would sit at the typewriter and type up some quick little thing about this little birdhouse or this and that. And when we did that, we had at least, I would say, 10, 12 covers a year, which we said, hey, this is a great way to make money.
Yeah, one time we didn't have any money. We went down and bought an old couch. And I said, we're going to recover a couch. We didn't know anything about recovering upholstery. So when we got it finished, it was so wrinkled up. It looked terrible.
Then I said, you know what? We do retouching on people. Why don't we retouch those wrinkles out? So we retouched the wrinkles out a couple of years later and sold it as an article. I think we sold stories on every piece of furniture in our house.
And
we have two darkrooms, and one of them, the other darkroom is used for developing, and this darkroom is used for printing. So that way two people can work at the same time. One can be developing, another person could be printing.
I met Peter through a friend of his. One night he said, "I'd like to get a picture of you. I have a photographer friend." And I said, "Oh, well, no, I don't really, I'm not interested." But he said, "Well, let's just drop by." And so when I walked in the door, then I saw this adorable man standing there. He was sewing a piece of burlap to create a cover, a very tight cover for a box. He also had a beautiful photograph of a child above the mantelpiece. Peter said, "You know, you and I should be married." And I said, "Why?" He said, "Because you're 5 foot no. two and I'm 6 foot three, and our children would be perfect."
Come back here. December 7th, 1941, we had our second date. On December 21st, we went to Las Vegas, we got married. So it was such a shock to us, we said, "What have we done?"
The Gowland team was highly productive. From it came scores of magazine articles with photographs.
We were working on a thing where we could freeze models in their refrigerator, and then we would defrost them.
We did covers, alum covers. I love this one, campaign promises.
When people are getting married, they campaign and then they don't keep their promises.
They had two daughters, also useful in their business.
We'd get all set up and everything all ready to go, and then she'd say, "I'm not going to do it."
Both of our girls are bright, very bright. They are, they're brighter than we are, to tell the truth. Proud to say we were working for Playboy.
They were innocent pictures that...
The girl was not undressed fully. She could show the part of her breast and that's it. I don't know whether our daughters liked it that much either, because people say, "Oh, your dad does girly pictures," and things like that. They didn't look at it as a really prestigious thing. And so then when they started showing pubic hair and all this, I said, "You know what, we don't need this anymore." So we just never did do any others. So finally, the last one that we did, the girl, it was a really pretty picture, but afterwards, that girl committed suicide.
I think a girl is born beautiful is cursed with beauty.
They stopped doing business with one type of magazine, but the Peter Gowland photographs of pretty women kept selling to calendar companies and photographic magazines. School, Peter aspired to draw pictures of women.
I was sitting next to girls that could paint horses and that could paint women and all this kind of stuff. I was so frustrated because all I could do was draw automobiles and, you know, draw with a compass and a ruler. And so I never felt I was an artist, and I wasn't. With photography, I was able to fake it. A person that's with no talent could be a photographer.
He loves to put himself down. You have no sense at all that you have any talent, that anything's... I can't believe that.
I think everybody...
Even with all the fame and people calling you, he goes, "Oh, no." He...
They wrote 21 books on various aspects of photographing women. Alice did the actual writing, but in order to make money selling the books, the publishers said, one man should be identified as the author and expert on women.
Without Alice, there wouldn't be anything.
When I was a very little girl, I always read stories about girls who were adventurous and came through and did something great, either for their country or for their village or their people. That's the kind of stories I read as a child. I wanted to find a man and be behind him. I never cared about knowing who I was or any glory or anything like that.
This woman has done a lot for this man.
Oh, no, I'm further back than you, so okay. I can never do this. Failed again. I'm always failing.
The thing I was thinking about was the picture would be shooting us sitting on the bed. We watch television on the bed, say. And so we're on the bed, and then the raccoons will come to the, they'll come to the, they'll come. Oh, yeah. You better give him a glass of wine.
Oh, that's so funny. He never would go to lunch. I mean, that's the last thing in the world Peter would ever go to lunch with anyone. And he had gone on an errand, and he was very late coming back, and I was so worried. I thought something had happened to him. And then he came back and said, oh, well, yeah, I decided to have lunch with, and he named this person that we know. That was very strange to me because it was not believable. But I just let it, I thought, oh, well, so that happened. Then it came again. He would be gone. And he'd always have some reason, and then I got very suspicious and very upset over that. I was afraid something was going on. I confronted him once with it, and he wouldn't say anything. He wouldn't tell me, and it was very difficult. He said, no, you're just imagining things, and so I let that go, and it was a very stressful time in my life because I didn't want to appear to be a witch and being one of these suspicious women, but I started kind of, you know, looking into things and being like a little detective, and sure enough, I did find out that there was another woman involved, and that was it was absolutely devastating. It's absolutely devastating if your husband tells you not that he's having an affair, but that he's in love with someone else. It's like a knife wound right through the heart.
One thing I want to tell you, Chris. You can drive my car, but please don't play with my squirrel.
With lots of pain and putting up with this and hearing it.
Thanks.
As long as he didn't want to leave.
Oh, well, that's sweet.
I admire
Thanks.
Your eyes.
Oh.
We would be on the set. We'd have models, we'd have the client there. We dealt with our business just the same as always.
When she closed her eyes, is she taken by surprise?
The woman Peter found outside his marriage is someone he will not name now, but someone he thought was crucial to who he wanted to be, to the hero, to the dashing man he wanted to feel like.
I I felt completely the one with all the guilt.
A friend of mine suggested I see a psychiatrist. I said, well, a psychiatrist, how's that going to help me? You know, I always thought psychiatrists only talk about cerebral things or dreams, and he was very realistic, and he said that a wonderful thing. He said, you know, in life you can't expect your happiness from a person. It has to be from within yourself.
I didn't want recognition or anything like that. I just loved being part of a person who had something creative he was doing. I lived for that.
Peter was just my whole life. I mean, sometimes when I wrote letters, I would think, well, who is the real Peter Gowan? Because I write like I was Peter Gowan. You know, the people get the letter and think Peter wrote it. But I started thinking about things that I really wanted to do, and the things I really wanted to do was to write stories. Go back to like when I was a child and wrote stories.
I took a creative writing class. Well, then when I started writing, I had something that I love to do, really love to do. Makes my day happy knowing that I'm going to be able to get up and write something.
I have a collection of short stories, and I still write short stories. I have never had a fictional story published, but it doesn't really matter that much. It would be nice, but that's what I love to do.
It was as though Peter thinks, well, what's the matter? She's not paying attention. This is almost like he was getting jealous of my love. So it was an interesting turnaround.
She was perfect to me in every way. So I was imperfect, and I couldn't make myself be perfect because I was a man, and men are stupid. They do stupid things that women don't do.
When Alice went to the psychiatrist.
And Peter was very curious. Oh, he just pumped me. What'd you say? Did you talk about me? And I said, look, that's between the two of us. If you want to know, you're welcome to go, but this is between this man and myself. And
I think that's why I went, because she wouldn't tell me what they were talking about.
And naturally, a man's ego thinks we're only talking about him. But
you weren't.
We were talking about me.
She was almost too perfect.
That's what I was doing wrong. When you're too attentive, you can smother a person unknowingly. And that was the term that was used, that I might have a tendency to smother someone, not intentionally, not even knowing it, but because I'm always there and did the cooking and was always with helping with everything. That's not really the best thing to do. You have to have your own thing too. And that was very good advice.
So she had to change slightly, but I had to change a lot more than she did.
And the thing that amazed me was going to the psychiatrist, he didn't put me down like I expected.
He's still a friend today. He was the one that said, the next book you write, I want to see your name on that cover.
Now Peter doesn't like me to get out of his sight. You can't make someone not love someone and stop loving someone, because what would that do to your relationship with that person? If they love someone and you come between them, they're certainly not going to love you very much. So it could have been me. Maybe I would have fallen in love, even though I can't see of it. Maybe I could have fallen madly in love. And when love is something you cannot control, it's almost like being crazy. It's close to being crazy. So that's one of the reasons that I stuck with it, because just to see if it would run its course.
This person found somebody who was much better than I, a little bit younger, and had a little bit more money, and it was a terrific relationship they have. And I'm happy for it. And I saw her one day at the airport, and she came with a little baby under her arm, and I started crying because I was so happy. I wanted her to to have a life with a baby, see? And I was too old for her. She was maybe 25 years older or something like that. So I wanted her to be happy and have what she deserved, see? And so we're still friends, and I talked to her, and I talked to her husband on the phone, and he says, when are you coming up to see us? You're part of the family.
But, I was thinking that it is interesting because I hear so many times in these silly talk shows where the husband once goes out or looked at another woman at a party, and these women go, oh, out. And I think you are a fool because this is the way men are. I mean, men, so what? I wouldn't want a husband that never looked at another woman and was that kind of, you know what I'm saying? I don't want him to go do that necessarily, but it's part of a man's... not having affairs, I'm not meaning that, but at a party, so many women can't stand it if their husband looks and talks to someone else. I think they're being very silly and they're going to lose that relationship.
I think when you like a person, you like them as a, I think they've got to be a friend. I think that's what we are. We're good, we're close friends, and no one I'm closer to than Alice in the world. And we can go out with people at dinner and I can look at her and say, you're going to cry now, see? And something happens, I just reach over and put my hand on her shoulder like this.
See? And then we either laugh or cry. We've made our own personal Christmas cards.
I think my favorite is when Alice patted herself up and I got a policeman's uniform and she was Zsa Gabor and I was a Beverly Hills cop. I like that one. We got a Rolls Royce.
And I liked the one we did on our 40th anniversary because I was in a wedding dress and he was in his, you know, a nice, beautiful morning suit or whatever you call it, and I'm chasing him with a rolling pin down the beach.
What makes a man great? It may not be his skill or his reputation among his colleagues. It may not be his achievement of making a career out of his hobbies. It may be simply that he has achieved gratitude for what he has and who he has to share it with.
I think we've had a terrific life. Life isn't really terrible at all. I think of all the people I know, I think probably that I'm the luckiest. I don't know whether Alice is, but...
I think we both were very lucky.
My parents were divorced twice. My two daughters have been divorced. My brother's been married 6 times. And I look at all these people and I think, are they better off being divorced? And I think in most cases, I think marriage is a great institution. And who wants to live in an institution?
Well, see, if you have something going for you, which we did, we knew that we had something going. We knew we liked so many things together. Then it's worth fighting for it.
I guess we're married. We're going to stay married a little longer, huh?
Probably. We never can say.
Is it possible to make
it the
same size
with
the big square? Yes.
Goodbye, dear.
This might be the last kiss.
Oh, I hope not.
A kiss may sometimes be a request. When Peter kisses Alice now, it's a promise.